Hello, I'm Logan O'Brien, and welcome to The Tube, a vlog all about television. So for years, it was argued that television had no purpose whatsoever other than to rot your brain from the inside out, make you die a horrible early death because supposedly only lazy, stupid, fat people sat in front of the box all day watching television. But now, wannabe intellectuals are claiming that television, certain television shows, have some sort of artistic value and should be discussed at length on an intellectual level. And so today we're going to take a look at what caused this, and what led up to this, the changes throughout the history of TV. It's going to be a brief look, but we're going to put emphasis on what's happened in the last 20 years when it comes to television. All right, here goes. Now in the early days of TV, there were predominantly three forms of television you could watch. There was the news, there was boxing, and then there were kiddie-friendly cartoons. Starting in 1951 with a radio program-turned-TV show called Dragnet, TV began going off in a different direction. Dragnet presented detective stories with an unparalleled level of realism and grit for the time, and it was years before another show was as ballsy as Dragnet was. However, Dragnet wasn't a particularly deep show and didn't have some underlying message. It just gave you the facts.
I work here. I'm a cop. It was Tuesday, April 7th. It was cold in Los Angeles. We were working the day watch out of Accident Investigation Division, Hit and Run Felony Unit. My partner's Frank Smith. The boss is Captain Calfee. My name's Friday.
Fast forward to the 60s, and you get overtly goofy and poorly acted, albeit overall enjoyable, early sci-fi gem Star Trek, the first science fiction show with a big budget, though you wouldn't really guess it looking at it now.
If I get into any trouble, I'll quit.
While it's very easy to poke fun at Star Trek, signs that it wanted to be taken more seriously than just another sort of science fiction show like Flash Gordon are very apparent even at the end of the first season, with the shockingly bleak and moving episode, The City on the Edge of Forever.
What are you?
I am the Guardian of Forever.
No, Jim!
The 80s saw a continuation of high-budget sitcoms, such as the fantastically memorable A-Team, which followed a group of rogue soldiers of fortune. As well as primetime soap operas, such as the epic Dallas, which was the first show to ever truly make you feel like a failure and a bastard for not being a billionaire oil tycoon. Prick. The 90s were somewhat of a cartoon revival for television due to the smash success of shows such as Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, the superb Pokemon, and the bright and cheery Sailor Moon. However, the shape of things to come for television within the next decade, or what defined it for the next decade, came in 1999, when the television world got a metaphorical electric jolt on each testicle with a phenomenal show known as The Sopranos. Now, if you've been living in a rock under the sea for the last 15 years, The Sopranos was an HBO cable series that followed the lives of New Jersey mafia boss Tony Soprano and his family. The show ran from 1999 to 2007 and spawned a new genre of gritty, vulgar, violent, sexually permissive, anything-goes-style drama series on cable TV, which had previously been saturated with cheap softcore pornography and Steven Seagal movies.
Why don't you just calm down and perfectly calm?
Well, we can talk about whatever's bothering you.
Yeah?
Tony, this is crazy.
Ow! Tony!
Rat.
Who are you? What is this?
Don't make me laugh. You pimp. You fuck.
Teddy, there must be something we could do.
Tony. It's Tony, you fuck.
You know how much trouble you're in now? You took an oath, and you broke it.
I could have killed you last night outside the motel. Your daughter was drunk, remember? I was there in the parking lot. I had a gun, but I didn't do it. Because of her, I told myself, it's just a coincidence. It's taking this little girl to college.
You know, one thing about us wise guys, the hustle never ends. You shot me at that motel, your life would have been flushed on a piece of dude.
Please, honey, I'm begging.
Jimmy says hello from hell, you fuck.
In 2001, following on the coattails of the success of The Sopranos, HBO launched another superb show, 6 Feet Under, which revolved around a family who runs a funeral home and the people they interact with. 6 Feet Under put an emphasis on personal struggles and conflicts, often crossing over into the surreal.
They don't.
Good morning.
What's going on with you?
Nothing.
Told ya. Now, HBO continued to dominate the cable TV drama realm into 2002 with the release of the fantastic show, The Wire. Now, The Wire is, in my opinion, the best television show of all time.
Shit.
On the surface, The Wire seems like a no-holds-barred cop versus gangster drama. However, rather than just focusing on that, it touches into each facet of bureaucracy in Baltimore where it takes place. Now, I know that some people have made the argument that The Wire is not just a crime drama, but that it's really about America and how the citizens have to live together and how everyone is a slave to whatever institution they're involved in, whether it be with drug dealers or the police department or the public education system or the Port Authority, and whatever the case is, it just makes for bloody good television that I highly recommend you check out if you get the chance, because it is gritty as all hell and incredible as long as you watch it with subtitles.
Let me ask you something, though. Being that you muscle for Marlowe, what you was gonna do if you was there, huh? We don't need that. Yeah. You know what, yo?
In 2006, cable network Showtime entered the ring with a darkly comedic show called Dexter, which follows the exploits of a likable blood splatter analyst who works for the Miami-Dade Police Department and moonlights as a serial killer. Dexter's catch, though, is that he doesn't kill just anyone. He kills other killers and bad guys that have escaped the hands of justice, but the interesting thing that the show does is that it never really portrays him as a vigilante. It portrays him as an addict and makes this very clear that his killing stems from an addiction, and he only kills bad people as a form of self-preservation, because with his connection with the police department, they're easier targets, and nobody's really going to miss them. Now, seasons 1 and 2 of Dexter are compellingly good television. However, it got kind of stale after season 2. 3 and 4, there were some exciting moments, but nothing too mind-blowing like seasons 1 and 2, which I highly recommend you check out if you can. Most video stores carry them to rent, and if you start on it, you'll finish it over the weekend. It's very, very addicting to watch this show. And Michael C. Hall from 6 Feet Under is in it. Now this is all led up to the show that truly cemented television on that whole artistic intellectual map, a show called Mad Men. Now, Mad Men follows the fictional Sterling Cooper advertising agency. However, the show really focuses more on the lives of the people who work at the firm. Now, in all honesty, I have absolutely no idea why Mad Men is hailed as not just one of the greatest TV shows of all time, but also as a great work of intellectualness and art. The show is surprisingly pointless. None of the characters, with their chain-smoking, alcoholic, adulterating lives, are exactly likable. And if you can stop ogling at Christina Hendricks' tits when she's on screen, you realize that the show is really empty. Now, that's not to say that Mad Men is a bad show, because it is not. What I'm saying about Mad Men, though, is that it is just damn near impossible to create any sort of emotional attachment to any of the male characters in it, because they are all twats. No other word for them. They're a bunch of twats. They are incredibly sexist. They're all cheating on their wives. They are working for an advertising firm and doing really fucked up shit with the advertising firm. As all advertising firms do, I will say that. But ad men have typically been villainized throughout television and cinema history, and this is no different. But what I am saying, though, is that, yeah, the plot line is very empty. Nothing really happens. However, for nothing to happen, it's incredibly entertaining for nothing to happen. But, you know, a possibility of this is that maybe the screenwriters and the creators are trying to say that these people's, their lives, are just as pointless as, you know, the things that go on in them. There's no point to what they're doing. But take it as you like, Mad Men is incredibly entertaining. But just to give you a show at what a bastard some of the characters are, here's a scene that stood out.
Let me get my purse.
Fix me a drink, will you?
I don't know.
Isn't that what these guys do all day? I've seen the movies. Pretend like I'm your boss. Donald Draper.
Okay, one drink. Dr. Harris, are you trying to examine me?
Maybe.
Not in here.
That Sterling guy knows an awful lot about you.
I've been working here for 9 years. Greg, don't. It is in my office.
It's okay.
No, I mean it. Greg, this isn't fun.
This is what you want, right?
Stop.
It's okay.
Greg, no.
That's all we have time for today. Go away now.